Brij Bhasin. Okay. From Rebright Partners.
So, what is Rebright Partners?
Rebright Partners is a Japanese venture capital fund. Okay. We started investing in India 5 years back, mm-hmm. and we've done 14 investments mm-hmm. across various sectors, mm-hmm. From logistics to healthcare to digital media, mm-hmm. deep tech, enterprise software. We typically invest at the early stage, so mm-hmm. putting in anywhere between a few hundred K USD to about $2 million.
Who are your investors? And when you say Japanese, what do you mean by that?
Yeah. So our LPs, our investors, are primarily mid to large Japanese corporations that are looking to invest in the India market, because of the emerging market opportunity.
The corporations, not asset owners, not pension funds and endowments. And
yeah, that. Currently we don't have any pension funds or endowments. Okay. We're primarily operating companies. They essentially want to explore, strategic partnerships, right? Possibly create a commercial plan together, maybe a joint venture as mm-hmm. these companies evolve and grow bigger. Mm-hmm.
Okay. And what is the common investment theme that binds together all the sectors that you mentioned that you invest in?
Yeah. So the common theme is building for India, creating businesses that are solving the unique problems in India. Mm-hmm. These could be infrastructure related, lack of access, lack of mm-hmm. Products and services at the right price point. So these are localized solutions for the mm-hmm. India market. Mm-hmm. So that's one big theme that we follow. And, especially if you look at our investments in healthcare mm-hmm. Or logistics, they follow mm-hmm. that theme on how do we solve problems in India. Mm-hmm. The second theme is using Indian talent mm-hmm. to build global products. Right? So mm-hmm. where we've made investments in enterprise software or deep tech, mm-hmm. where these companies are creating products, maybe doing the POC and initial validation in the local market. Mm-hmm. But firmly the idea is to grow beyond the shores. Perhaps we can help them look east, mm-hmm. where most startups tend to look west. Mm-hmm. We help them build channel partnerships and co-selling opportunities in the Japanese market.
Okay. Yeah. So give us an example of each. So one, a local Indian company. So what is your biggest bet in that space?
Sure. So we've done an investment called Let's Transport. It's a last mile logistics aggregator. Mm-hmm. They essentially help small truck owners mm-hmm. find enterprise clients. Right. Mm-hmm. So of course, logistics and infrastructure transportation is one of the most inefficient sectors in India.
So kind of like an Uber for trucks.
Exactly. Okay. But done very differently because Uber is more on demand. Right. This is more scheduled. So we work with large companies like a Bisleri or a Coke or an Amazon or a Flipkart mm-hmm. and we give them enterprise dashboard and mm-hmm. SLAs to manage their 3PL logistics needs.
And an example of where Indian talent is being used for global solutions?
Yeah. So we invested in a company called Tuki Taki, where they started off as a big data analytics company. Mm-hmm. And over time, they then started to focus on the banking and finance sector, mm-hmm. where they created software for anti-money laundering and fraud analytics for banks. Mm-hmm. We helped them connect with the banking clients in Singapore mm-hmm. and Japan. Mm-hmm. So the company actually put a lot of resources and set up their operations in Singapore. Mm-hmm. And now majority of their clients are outside of India. So they're mm-hmm. working with some of the largest banks in Singapore and Japan. And selling their products there.
What are some of the unique sort of points you see while you're investing mm-hmm. in India? Mm-hmm. And what are some of the challenges that you see that are still unsolved?
Sure. So one of the most unique points is just the need for digitization. The need for sort of automation is extremely huge. And if you see any sector, whether it's transportation, healthcare, we've done trading businesses or B2B commerce. We've recently invested in an agri-tech company which is using software and sensors to improve farm yield, bringing in more tracking and automation in that. So how do we bring in more software and more tech into improving efficiency, creating more value for our customers and consumers? So that's one big theme.
But what do you see in India? I mean, is India that far behind what you see elsewhere in the world? I mean, in these
These challenges are similar everywhere, right? Yeah. So if you, for example, if you take in healthcare, we have a company that's doing telemedicine, so remote doctor consultation. India is uniquely positioned in the sense that we have very low access to tier 2, tier 3 towns for specialist doctors. But even if you look outside, whether it's in China or in the US or especially in Japan, and in Japan the regulatory environment is not set up for similar businesses, but the need is still there. I mean, their population is aging. You know, there is need for them to provide healthcare in rural areas where there's not enough medical professionals. So that's actually one of our themes, where how do we improve access to products and services outside of major cities.
So in today's session, you were on the health panel.
Yeah.
What was the company that, or what was your sort of take on that space? Healthcare.
Yeah, so I think in healthcare, the challenges and the need is, you know, everyone's well aware of that. I think the issue that we talked about in terms of inertia and adoption of new tech and new products is most acute in healthcare, right? And rightly so. I mean, you're dealing with people's lives, and you have to have products and services that are well suited and well validated, I should say. So I believe the need is to, you know, be able to create an ecosystem where we can sort of move things faster, where, you know, if the information sharing and validation is happening in a cohesive ecosystem, then those ideas can spread and those products can spread faster. I think that's one of the key things, right? Because as a startup, you don't have enough time. You only have money for so many years before you have to start to show scale.
I was going to say that. I mean, what's the rush? And the rush is coming from the fact that you have investors to give returns to, as opposed to the patients. Obviously, a patient is incentivized for their own health, right? So if they're not adopting something, it's because they don't trust it. So you wanting to change human behavior faster than it can change is your problem, because you have promised your investors. Why wouldn't you go back to investors and say, we need a longer sort of time horizon?
So we're actually one of the few funds, we have a 10-year horizon on our fund cycle, right? So we are long-term patient investors and willing to wait to how do we get that validation. And yes, it is the job for the shareholders and the management to explain the product, show the value, create acceptance, and move forward. And more than the patients, actually the medical community, right? Where there are established norms, there are established processes, where, you know, we do see initial adoption, right? There are quite a few medical professionals who are sort of the opinion leaders, who are the risk takers.
Give an example of what one particular company.
So if you look at any medical device company, right, they will typically have a few POCs, you know, they'll have a couple of hospitals, couple of doctors who would adopt it. But then after that, it's a bit of a challenge to scale it, right? There's a big gulf in the middle. And I think that's where, if there is a better channel created, you know, so for example, you know, we invested in a company called Medica Bazaar, which is now working on B2B medical supplies integration, right? So they're a trading platform. So they sell medical supplies from all the way to largest hospital to the smallest clinics. So we are trying to work towards improving this distribution and getting access to new products across the country.
Okay. What is your take on IVCA? What role does IVCA play in the development for your fund? And what's your feedback to them in terms of good or bad? What they can do better?
No, I am really happy that IVCA is taking such an active role in the community. One of the best things I like is that they're they're the voice for investors and startups with the government, right? I mean, we do have to interface and we have to explain what we're doing and you know, work towards creating a environment where there's easier processes and ease of doing business. And I think on that front, IVCA has been a very big help, right? And they're continuing to do so. I think these forums are great to kind of bring people together and get more conversations.
Any feedback to the government that you weren't too happy with?
I'm very impressed with the government to actually be receptive and hearing and proactive on listening to the issues and figuring out how they can redirect and fix those problems. I think a bit of predictability in policy making would help investors in, you know, in certain sectors. There's been a bit of a back and forth on certain policies, which create a more uncertain environment. And even though we are long-term investors, you know, there's always this sort of fear that, okay, after we have invested, if the policy changes, then what happens to our portfolio companies, to, you know, so who will support them further, right? So some predictability and reliability on policymaking would be helpful.
Great. Thank you very much. Anything else you want to say?
No, I think thanks for having me.
Okay.